is a special WNVC sports presentation.
Welcome to Sports Sidelines. Today we're going to take a look at the sport of soccer. Soccer, a relatively new arrival to the American sports scene, is internationally known as the king of sports. In the United States today, an estimated 5.7 million youths are playing soccer. In the Northern Virginia, Maryland, and D.C. area, over 55,000 youths are playing today. Now here's the host of Sports Sidelines, Matt Miller.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Sports Sidelines. I'm Matt Miller, and in this edition of Sports, we're going to take a look at soccer, where it is on the youth, college, and professional level. Right now, I'd like to introduce someone to you, though, that's in our studios to give us a little insight on that, Len Bilous. He is an ex-major coach of Major Indoor Soccer League. He has coached in Cincinnati, Pittsburgh, and Philadelphia. He is currently a director of Soccer Magic Camps, and he is a staff coach of the U.S. Soccer Federation. Len, it's a pleasure to have you here today.
Thank you, Matt. It certainly is very nice to be here.
I guess one of the first questions I'd like to talk to you about is, what started soccer in the United States? What was the key to that?
Matt, that was something very simply that the immigrants coming over here from Europe and from South America and other countries brought with them as one of their natural pastimes. If you follow the sport internationally, that's really the biggest game in the world, and when the immigrants brought it over with them, they just continued to play, and the game flourished on a very limited basis with mostly the ethnic clubs.
Where has, here's a two-part question for you. Where has soccer come in the last 5 years? Where is it heading in the next five on the professional level?
Well, Matt, in the professional level, you have to look at two different aspects of the game. At first, in this country, we only had the outdoor game, and that has gradually diminished in impact and in popularity. Some of the reasons being that the American kids were not getting a chance to play. Some of it was lack of marketing by the professional leagues, and some of it was because the American public demands a slightly different game. Whereas the next following, the coming 5 years, I think is going to show us what has already happened in the last 5 years, a continuation of it and a growth of it. And that is that the major indoor soccer league stepped in to fill a void for the fans and also for the American players. In the last 5 years, we went from a six-team league to, I believe, now a 13 or 14 league, 14-team league. And I think in the future, you're going to see probably even greater expansion there. Also, throughout the country, because of the popularity of the indoor game, you're seeing many, many, I would say over 50 facilities now that are strictly indoor soccer facilities rented as they were when we had the popularity of ice hockey, where you had kids going in and playing with leagues and so on. That is now happening with the indoor soccer game.
I think in the metropolitan area, including Maryland, D.C., and Virginia, the soccer program has taken off. In Annapolis, they held the Olympic trials, and they held the soccer games, and thousands of people were there. But the thing that shocked me was in the Olympics, they didn't devote that much coverage to soccer, but they were drawing 100,000 people for games that the United States wasn't even in California.
Yes, I think, Matt, that's a touchy subject, especially for some of the networks who covered the Olympics. I believe if the United States team had a really good shot at gaining one of the medals, then I think the coverage would have been there. But unfortunately, the U.S. team was not projected as being a top-notch team and was not going to be able to compete internationally with, say, Italy, France, Germany, and so on. They were not accorded that kind of coverage. In the future, I think, and already we have seen with the U.S. playing the Netherlands Antilles a week or so ago, there was national coverage, because what was feared as not being, not having the interest in this country, all of the experts were fooled. And when you saw 103,000 people watching the final between France and Italy, or France and Brazil, then it became obvious that soccer here has arrived, and there is a lot of interest for the indoor and the outdoor game as well.
Okay, one final question on the Olympics. In your opinion, how many more Olympics before we can fight for a medal? The next, in 4 years, or is it going to take 8, do you think?
See, that's the age-old question, Matt, and I think we can arrive possibly in the next 4 to 8 years. Right now, I feel that we have reached parity with the countries in the Central Caribbean and North American continent, but with countries in Europe and countries in South America, we are still behind. And I think once we arrive and are competitive on that level, then we have a really good shot at a medal, if not the gold.
To change the subject from professional to youth level, in this area, I can ride around in my car and see hundreds of youths and parents out. What kind of impact is that going to have on soccer down the road?
Well, Matt, already it is showing a tremendous impact. For advertisers, it's become one of the leading sports to advertise in. As far as these kids progressing from the high school level to the collegiate level and then to the professional level, we already are seeing a lot of inroads. Down the road, we can expect these kids to continue to improve. We have large numbers. Now it's just a matter of improving the quality and taking the best players, training them together as they did in, say, volleyball, and then being able to face the toughest opposition and do well against them.
For all our soccer viewers, is soccer going to be a profession where they can make a career out of it after college?
I would say so, Matt. Right now, we have a struggling outdoor league, maybe a couple of struggling outdoor leagues. The USL is in there, but they're also struggling. The major indoor soccer league is the league that everybody is looking forward to as a leader now in the development of professional soccer in this country. However, that may not be enough for all of these kids to get involved in playing and creating a profession for them. I think what we'll see developing down the road, and we have a minor indoor league now, which will be operating out of the Midwest, I think we're going to continue to see this kind of regional professional league forming, and this will give great opportunity and more opportunity for all of the kids who are coming up and playing. And I think down the road we may even see some of this translating into women's professional soccer.
That's what was my next question. How does women's and men, boys and girls soccer compare with each other?
Well,
how far apart or how close are they?
In this country, the women's programs got started a little bit after the men's programs. So the men's programs have several generations of lead time. Therefore, the quality is much higher on the men's level. However, I've seen some women's competitive regional Olympic teams, and they play a tremendous quality of soccer. And internationally, the women are doing better than the men, because internationally, the women's soccer is not emphasized. It's the men's soccer that is the kingpin. So in one sense, the women's soccer is lagging, and the other sense, they're really advanced.
I'm glad you brought that up. I have to go back to, you're going to see this tape in just a moment, but you had some young ladies out there at this camp that really impressed me.
Yes.
And that's my next question. What effect do your camps have? A major impact, or is it just to help them along with the other coaching they receive, or do you feel that you can really help children that are on the borderline?
Well, I think our camp and the format that we use, which emphasizes the development of skills, is going to be able to benefit every child who attends, and does benefit every child who attends. System that we like to use is to challenge the player to reach their highest potential. See, and it doesn't matter whether the kid is a beginner or whether the kid is intermediate or an advanced player. We're going to be able to challenge them. And part of it is because of the staff that we employ, including myself and TJ. We have coached at a very high level, and we know what to expect and how to measure up, not only locally, but also to measure up players to the international standard.
Is it hard for you as a professional coach in a number of cities to relate to younger children and not try to drive them too hard?
Now, my experience with soccer initiated at the youth level, and I coached many kids at several soccer camps throughout the East Coast. I enjoy working with the kids, and I think that's the key. If you enjoy working with kids, then you can accomplish quite a bit, and you can relate to them and make them progress according to whatever their level of accomplishment potential is. And I have no problems with it, not only that, but it gives me a lot more satisfaction because I can see a tremendous growth in a short period of time. And I think the to answer your question, what can the kids achieve? It's if we have the kids for only 1 week, then we're going to accomplish quite a bit because we have them for maybe 15 to 30 hours that week. If we were to keep them for several weeks or a month, I know that it would be a quantum jump in ability. And unfortunately, we're at the level in this country right now that there just isn't this kind of coaching available on a mass level. The youth programs have grown tremendously in the last 10 years, where by now we have over 2 million kids playing soccer. And really the coaching development and the refereeing and all other aspects of the game have not kept up with their growth.
Okay, we're going to roll this tape here for you now. What are they going to see right here of what we did at your camp?
Well, we worked on a couple of different skills, and we worked on some concepts that go along with the development of those skills. We never approach a situation as only a skill situation. We always look at a skill and say, what does this skill solve in a game situation? For instance, if we are receiving a ball or a pass from a teammate, are we just receiving the ball or are we exercising our vision so that we can play mentally at a quicker pace? So what we'll see here is one session where we're working on receiving and passing, whereby we are using not only our physical ability but also our mental ability. The phrase that I like to use is mind, body, and ball control combined as one unit. And we'll be working on that aspect of the game in the first clip, and then the second clip we're going to be working on shooting. And again, the exercise of the vision to pick out a target in the goal that we want to place the ball rather than just shooting the ball. Anybody can shoot, take a shot on goal, but not everybody will be a goal scorer.
So. And where are these kids from that we're seeing now?
The kids that are going to be working in these clips are from the local soccer clubs in this area. So I think it will be an indication of the quality of soccer that is available here right now and how we can go from the product that we now have and take it to a more advanced level.
Okay, you heard it from Len Bilous. We'll be talking to TJ Kostecki in just a moment, but let's take a look at those clips right now.
In this sequence of exercises, I act as a pressurizing defender so that the players get used to shooting with pressure of an opponent, just as they will have to do in a game. I start with a minimum amount of pressure, and as the success rate of the players increases, I can progressively add pressure so that we go from a match-related exercise to one that is performed under match conditions, that is one with full pressure of opponents, going to goal, and including a counterattack goal.
Okay, I want to thank you, Lenny, and it was exciting to go out to that camp, and for all your information, I'm sure it's helped our viewers. Thank you for being here.
Thanks, Matt. It certainly has been enjoyable working with you, and special thanks to the kids who came out and helped us run the clinic.
10 years ago, watching a soccer game in Northern Virginia was a difficult thing to come by. Today, we can see a soccer game in Northern Virginia about as often as we can see a basketball pickup game at any level of competition. At the college level, we find the George Mason Patriots in Fairfax, Virginia, as a perennial top 20 team in the nation. To tell us a little more about the growth of soccer in Virginia, here's head coach Dick Broad, the George Mason men's soccer team. Coach, where has soccer come from and where is it going in Northern Virginia and the state of Virginia in college level play?
We have an excellent region here. Our area of the country has a number of top teams. Virginia finished third in the country last year. Just here in the Capital Collegiate Conference, I think we've got four of the best teams in the East: American, Howard, George Washington, I think ourselves. So it's a good area for soccer, excellent area.
Okay. Where do you get the majority of your players from? Are they from leagues or high schools? Are you getting a good level of ability out of the high schools now that you didn't get several years back?
Well, we try to look at both the high schools and the club programs, look at a good player wherever we can find them. In terms of geographic area, about half the players in our 22-man squad from right here in Northern Virginia. We try to mix that in with a blend. We've got a couple real fine Canadian players and some players from other parts of the country, including Dallas and Atlanta and New Jersey, New York, places like this. But the majority of our players right here in our own backyard.
About real quick, tell us how it's changed and how many years it's taken to change to get to the level of play that we have in Virginia now.
Well, it's taken a long time. I know right here at George Mason, it doesn't come easy. I mean, we tell our players the only place that success comes before work is in the dictionary. A lot of hard work, a lot of input with a lot of people, and not just myself, but the people on the administration here at George Mason and people on my staff, my assistants, done a nice job. And it's taken a while. You know, it's a lot of not much genius, or genius is more perspiration than inspiration.
Okay, well, thank you. That's where soccer's come from and where it's going in Northern Virginia. Here with Keith Tucker, the head coach of the Howard University men's soccer team in Washington, D.C. Coach, how do you see soccer in Washington, D.C., how it's come along and where it's going, such as Howard and Georgetown University?
In the past 10 years since I've been in the United States, the standard of all the universities within the district has improved about tenfold. That's going along with the type of players that are in the United States now. How far it will go, it all depends upon the publicity, the television, and the newspapers. But right now, it's come a long way, but we still got a long way to go.
You have many players on your team from outside of this country. How do you attract players like that, and how have you attracted them in the past to come to a school such as Howard in Washington, D.C.?
Well, most of it's our alumni. Most of Howard is throughout the Caribbean, African countries, throughout the world. We have a lot of alumni, and they go back home and they talk about their experience over here in the United States and what you can get for playing soccer is a free education, and everybody applies. I get over 70, 80, 100 letters within this recruiting year, and it's the alumni. I go home and talk about it.
How do you see the growth of soccer on lower levels as well as college level in the District of Columbia? Has it reached a peak, or is it going to continue to grow in popularity?
Well, I don't think it's moved too much since I've been in the district. That's separate from Maryland and Virginia. Those are two power, states. But the district so far, it's very little soccer, and especially in the black schools, the high schools. I'm constantly, just got a phone call the other day about trying to find some coaches for the areas. They're not interested in it. I wish they were, because the sport is like, it's going to be big, and if the blacks in D.C. don't get a hold of it, or the American blacks, because got a lot of Caribbean in Washington, D.C., but if the American blacks don't get a hold of it, they're going to be left behind, and it's free education for all, and I hope that everybody can get a piece of it.
Hello, Mike Boudet here, and I'm here at George Mason University with the coach of the George Mason women's soccer team, Coach Hank Lung. Thanks for joining us today, Coach.
Thank you, Mike.
All right. You have quite an impressive background. You were a college player yourself at Drexel, is that right?
That's right.
And you also have been coaching for a long time on regional high school soccer and youth soccer. And you're on the U.S. Youth Soccer Association regional staff, right? Boys and girls.
That's correct.
All right. And you also were an assistant to the NASL Philadelphia Fury.
That's right.
Okay, regional directing their youth programs and so forth. With all this experience, one would suspect that you've got a lot of options and choices in terms of coaching. And along about 1982, you decided to pick up a brand new program here at George Mason and take the women's team on. How did you come to make that decision?
Well, it was a very opportune time for us, because coming through the ranks and being in the regional coach, as I was for the female program for Region 1 for USYSA, that's the United States Youth Soccer Association, I had a great feel for what was being promoted at that time and the amount of talent. And when George Mason said they were going to come into a situation that they were going to make a varsity right away and come into it full time and put the money into the program, scholarship-wise as well as budget-wise, to make it happen, then I said, hey, this sounds exciting, and it sounds like it was really something to take hold of.
And where do you, what would you like to see happen in the way of women's soccer in the NCAA level at this point? I mean, you said it's growing fast. What would you like to see continue to develop?
Well, we've got almost 200 schools now on a varsity basis. If we include the club teams, there are almost 300 schools now offering soccer on a female level of some sort. So it's a situation that's growing immensely. Of course, the NCAA has helped us also because they've legislated that all Division I and Division II schools must have X number of female sports, all right, in their programs. So now everybody's looking to soccer because it's a very inexpensive sport to start and get into. All you're talking about are uniforms and budgeting for travel if you're going to have any travel at all. But with all the great numbers of schools that are getting involved now, that's not even a big deal because now you can play a schedule of 15, 20 game schedule just within your own backyard. So the NCAA is helping our growth as well at the collegiate level. And I think that now it's going to be a situation starting next year. There's going to be tremendous parity now. There are going to be a wealth of good schools. There are more this year than ever before, and there will be even more so because more schools are offering scholarships, more schools are offering varsity programs, very competitive programs, and it's growing tremendously.
Yeah. You've heard from Len Bilous about the professional level and his thoughts on soccer. Now let's talk to T.J. Kostecki. And he's a former college player, so he'll be able to give us some insight on the college level. He's currently a director of Soccer Magic. He was the founder of a youth soccer club and past president of that soccer club. And TJ, it's a pleasure to have you here today.
Nice to be here, Matt.
They're going to be seeing you in just a few minutes working in the clinic that we did, that you and Lenny participated in. And I was really impressed with the time that you take with the kids and show them things. But what was your experience on the college level?
Right, as a college player, I had an opportunity to play locally here in Randolph-Macon College, which is located in Central Virginia. And at the same time, after a couple of years, I transferred and I played up in East Stroudsburg in Pennsylvania. So I've had an opportunity to play at a number of different schools and see the game evolve at that time period. And one of the points that I'd like to make that I've seen happen in the game is an influx of American players. In the past 10 years, we've had a large amount of foreign players that have stood out on a lot of the college teams. But in the past 10 years, the youth players have finally reached that college level and are making their mark on the college program.
I think that's apparent. Okay, you are a director of Soccer Magic, which you do camps all over.
Yeah.
Is it like a baseball or a football camp where you teach them the fundamentals, or is that what the kids are going to learn?
Specifically, it's a tactical and technical training where we have the children work with their skills, their individual skills, and also tactical problem solving on the field. One of the differences with our soccer programs compared to football or baseball camps is there's a definite demand for soccer programs in this country. Most of our parents have been growing up with football or basketball and baseball, and the kids usually can go right to the parent and ask them for help, or they're willing to help out their child. Unfortunately, at this time in this country, we have an influx of youth that are playing the game, and unfortunately, the parents haven't been exposed to it. So there's a need for coaching, quality coaching of techniques and tactics, and this is a need that we try to solve.
In your travels across the East Coast, how does this metropolitan area pair up with other states?
Northern Virginia is one of the hotbeds of soccer, not only in the East Coast, but in the entire country. One of the things that I've seen as being a coordinator in this area is the fact that there's a lot of unity among the different clubs. The parents have taken over, and they have really done a lot of positive stuff with the soccer clubs. After all, the games they usually have in tournaments, one of the things, friendship is a very important theme in soccer, and all the tournaments that I've been to, and it's throughout the East Coast, especially Northern Virginia, the teams pass to each other a patch symbolic of their own team that they play. So if we played against each other in a specific tournament, I would give you a memento of our own club, and you would hand me a memento of your club afterwards. So there's a togetherness amongst the players and amongst the clubs in this area.
So you feel the support from the parents and the community is really at a high level for soccer now?
Very much so. One of the keys to this support is, I think, the fact that a lot of positive reinforcement is being used. The coaching that we have in this country on the national level and on the junior national level, there are a number of coaches that they have an opportunity to share with the parents through clinics like ourselves their own philosophies of positive reinforcement. And because the parents have not been through the game, they're much more open to accept these kind of suggestions.
Okay, we've talked with Lenny about how the players are progressing. How's the coaching in the United States?
The coaching is progressing slowly but surely. One of the problems our coaches have is the fact that the players, they usually only have time to play once or twice a week with their kids, scheduled practice based on their own work schedule and the children's commitment. So what we need to have from our own players is we need more of a commitment in playing. as opposed to the once a week or twice a week practice, they need to play on their own a lot more to try to get more playing time in.
Okay, we're here talking with TJ Kostecki. I got one final question. Who is eligible for your camps that you give across the East Coast? Do you take all-stars? Is it like an all-star baseball camp where the all-stars are eligible, or is anyone in soccer?
We have different types of programs. The two programs that we've run in Virginia so far, Northern Virginia, one has been a select team program where we've coached a group of boys that are very experienced players that have been playing for a number of years, and the all-stars in their particular club. That was over in Fairfax. Another camp that we did run was in Burke, Virginia, which was open to an instructional camp, basically stressing technique and beginning tactics, solving problems.
How would the viewers find out about this?
They could either contact myself or our coordinator. We have a coordinator down here in Northern Virginia, Mike Boudet, located in McLean, Virginia. He's our Atlantic coordinator of Soccer Magic Camps.
Okay, I want to thank you, TJ. We are going to show you that number and address at the end of the show. But right now, we want to show you some of the exciting clinic that we taped earlier this week and give you an insight of how in-depth the training is.
Okay, at this point, we're going to review and exercises which consist of passing and receiving. Our main focus will be receiving the ball and speed, visual speed. So we're going to ask the players to receive the ball using eye contact as opposed to calling for the ball to make the game go a lot faster. Right. This exercise will involve two players. The balls will also be on the ground. And once we receive the ball, we're going to look for another player to pass the ball to as quickly as possible. The key is, again, receiving, visually identifying what the player has in front of him, and then passing the ball off.
Good. Teammate one is open. He passes the ball back. Let's do it again. And do a little bit of movement, Mark, and Chris, to move around. If you're under pressure, you can pass the ball. Good stuff. Yes. Good. Good. We do a good look with the eyes. Very important to make sure you look with the eyes before the ball arrives so I identify your target. Good stuff.
In the United States today, soccer is a contrast of success and of failure. In the 1984 Summer Olympic Games in Los Angeles, the most popular event was soccer, garnering more than 1.4 million fans in attendance. Yet our own outdoor professional game has taken a turn for the worse. The North American Soccer League is literally fighting for survival, with fewer than 10 teams at present. Meanwhile, the major indoor soccer league is proving itself palatable to American spectators. And nearly everyone can attest to the success of youth soccer. The future for soccer in America is the youth. Thanks for watching Sports Sidelines. Any additional questions or comments on soccer or soccer magic camps, please address to 3613 North Vernon Street, Arlington, Virginia, 22207.
Because we're living today, so don't blame the youth. What do you say?
My mother went to